Okay, so today we're going to look at how to do an IOC about Macbeth. Last time we looked at how to do an IOC for Robert Frost or poetry. So I'm not going to talk too much about all the general tips that I mentioned last time. If you want to see them, you should watch the Robert Frost video. One thing that is still very important when doing an IOC about Macbeth or any play is the structure. Okay, remember your structure is very important, not just for your criterion C, but in making sure that you score highly in criterion A and B as well. So the structure I'm going to use here, first of all, I'm going to give a brief introduction to Macbeth and William Shakespeare, and I'm going to give my thesis statement. Your thesis statement, just like before, is very, very important. I'm then going to give a scene summary. So what happens during this extract, what happens immediately before, and what happens immediately after. And this is really important if you have your IOC about a play. You really have to know the sequencing of action. It's very important. I'm going to talk about why the scene is significant in terms of the themes of the play. And I'm going to use some close textual analysis. I'm then going to talk about the characterization of Macbeth and Banquo, and I'm going to give some close textual analysis. I'm then going to talk about the mood of the scene, and once more, I'm going to give close textual analysis to back up all the points I'm making. I'm then going to give my conclusion, which obviously I'm going to link back to my thesis statement. So I'm going to be looking at Act 1, Scene 3, and remember your IOC extracts will only be 40 lines. To make things easy, I have numbered the lines in this extract from 1 to 40. Okay, so let's begin. As I said, hopefully this is going to be no more than 12 minutes maximum, because remember, after that, then you will be having a guided conversation with your teacher. And just before we begin, my thesis statement, the main theme of Macbeth is the danger of ambition without morality. This is Act 1, Scene 3. This extract has been taken from William Shakespeare's The Tragedy of Macbeth, which was first performed in 1606. And Shakespeare wrote this play partly to appease King James I, who was new to the throne in England and who had recently survived the gunpowder plot. The main theme of Macbeth is the danger of ambition without morality. In this extract from Act 1, Scene 3, Macbeth and Banquo, on the way to the king's court, meet the three witches. And Macbeth and Banquo are initially disturbed by the witches' unnatural appearance. The witches give the two noblemen their prophecy. They greet Macbeth as the Thane of Clamis, Cawdor, and say he'll be king in the future. And the witches also give Banquo a very ambiguous prophecy. Immediately before this scene, the audience has seen the witches' plan to meet with Macbeth. We've also heard of Macbeth and Banquo and how crucial they were in the Scottish victory over both the rebel Maconwald and Norwegians. Macbeth's nobility and valour are mentioned several times. We also hear how Macbeth will be given the title of Thane of Cawdor, the title of the rebel that Macbeth slew personally. And at the start of this scene, the witches talk of their unnatural and cruel deeds. And just after this extract, Macbeth and Banquo discuss their respective prophecies. Macbeth is told that he's been made Thane of Cawdor and starts to fantasize about this full prophecy coming true. And when King Duncan announces he's going to stay at Macbeth's castle, Lady Macbeth urges her husband to take advantage and seize the crown. And therefore, the significance of this extract in terms of the plot, action, and development is that we hear the witch's prophecy for the first time, and this is crucial in driving the plot of this tragedy. So, as mentioned, one of the themes of Macbeth is the danger when ambition is not governed by morality. And this scene is hugely significant in this respect, because we see at the start of Macbeth's transformation from noble hero to treacherous villain. The repetition of "All Hail Macbeth" in lines 19 to 21 by the witches emphasizes the power of ambition. Macbeth is already Thane of Glamis, and he will soon find out that he is Thane of Cawdor. And after this prophecy, he will be obsessed with the idea of being king. By repeating their greeting, the witches imply that ambition is layered, and Macbeth is capable of reaching the highest layer. And from Macbeth's point of view, as he achieved two of the layers, why can't he achieve the third? Another key theme of Macbeth is the theme of the unnatural. Just before this extract, we see the witches talk of how they've been torturing a sailor for trivial reasons. They even refer to themselves as the Weird Sisters in line 1, and they make a reference to the number 9 in line 5. And number 9 is a number sort of often associated with black magic and cats. And the effect on the audience, especially in 1606, when witchcraft was really seen as a credible menace to society, would be to realise how unnatural and how dangerous these witches are. And Banquo's first reaction is to claim that these look not like the inhabitants of the earth, which is reinforcing the idea that this scene is a meeting of the natural world, Macbeth and Banquo, and the unnatural world, the witches. And Shakespeare wants to show that the ambition that the witches instill in Macbeth is unnatural and therefore immoral. And James I wrote a famous book called Demonology before he became king, which was a study of the methods dark magic used to bother humans. And Shakespeare is thought to have been inspired by his patron's book when creating the witches and talking about the black arts in Macbeth. And this scene also shows us the start of Macbeth's transformation. And Shakespeare uses dramatic irony when Macbeth utters, "So foul and fair a day I have not seen," in line 8, and this is almost identical to the spell that the witch has cast at the end of Act 1, Scene 1. And this is also foreshadowing that, you know, the audience can't help but think that the witch at Macbeth will end up committing unnatural deeds, just like the witches. And while Macbeth is unaware of this, the audience can already see that he is linked with these witches in a way that he appears powerless to resist or fully understand. And once Macbeth has heard the prophecy that he will be king, Banquo describes him in line 28 as being rapt with awe, and he's sort of speechless or deep in thought. And he's already beginning to process the idea of him being king in his head. And the effect on the audience is for us to question why Macbeth appears to be taking the prophecy of these fairly ridiculously looking witches so seriously. And we know at this point, through dramatic irony, that he is the Thane of Cawdor, but he doesn't. And also, Banquo still refers to him as noble in lines 25 and 27. And this really emphasizes the conflict between good and evil that is already happening to our protagonist. And the tone in this scene is one of eerie confusion. Banquo, for example, is told he will be lesser than Macbeth and greater, not so happy, yet much happier, and thou shalt get kings, though thou be none, in lines 36 to 38 respectively. And this verbal irony gives the audience the idea that the witches possess a sort of a visional power beyond our comprehension, and it's reinforced with this riddle to the audience. And the grotesque appearance of the witches gives us an uncanny feel of one of unease as we see these two valiant heroes struggling to make sense of the witches' prophecy. And the deliberate juxtaposition of ideas in lines 36 to 38 further reinforces the tone of contradiction and of confusion. So to conclude, Act 1, Scene 3 is a crucial scene in William Shakespeare's Macbeth as it reinforces themes of the unnatural and the dangers of ambition without morality through stylistic features such as repetition, dramatic irony, and juxtaposition. Okay, so I hope that was useful for you. And once again, good luck with your IOCs.